It's Wednesday, middle of the work week, and you've decided to spend some quality time here or hop on over to the hottest show on the streets, the number one forum for Alabama football news, notes, and information. Hope you got that popcorn ready, the butter in the popcorn, as you're locked and loaded on to In My Own Words with yours truly, Stephen M. Smith of Touchdown Alabama Magazine. Excited to have each and every last one of you here on today. Got a lot to touch on, talk about, digest, dive into when you discuss Crimson Tide football, as we're bringing this to you from Tuscaloosa, streaming this via YouTube. Speaking of the channel, go ahead right now, drop a thumbs up, give a like on the show, hit that subscribe button, and turn on all of those notifications so that you can have the best news, notes, updates, alerts, and analysis on your Crimson Tide. And speaking of Touchdown Alabama Magazine, as always, you can purchase individual copies of the magazine and have them sent to your door. The link will be found in the description. You can purchase individual copies of the brand of Touchdown Alabama Magazine, having your own little keepsake, having those sent to your door. The link is in the description. But we start things off with checking out the better half of the show, the man that makes it do what it does, the man, the myth, the legend, the maestro in the production studio. Hey, John Ivory, what's going on? Happy Wednesday.
Doing great. What's up to the fans? Roll Tide. Make sure I share the show and like the chat up. We got a great show tonight.
Got a huge show prepared for you guys, and we want you being a part of the conversation. As always, you can do that by calling 205-448-1358. Once again, the number 205-448-1358. And one more time, 205-448-1358. Going to be fun to chat up with or check in with former Alabama wide receiver Matt Caddell a little bit later on in the show. But we start things off giving an update here. Our prayers and best wishes of recovery do go out to Alabama offensive coordinator Steve Sarkisian. According to the Alabama Athletics Communication Department, the Alabama football coaching staff, they participate in mandatory physicals in the offseason. Sarkisian's physical was on Thursday of last week in Birmingham. The physicians there saw something that they needed to address, to take care of. You know, Sark had a congenital cardiovascular anomaly, or what's commonly referred to as a congenital heart issue. Now, the physicians there did not think it would become very, very serious, but just to take precautions, just to make sure, they did advise Sark to opt in and have the procedure done, of which he did have the heart surgery done on last week. He's now back in Tuscaloosa recovering, getting his rest in. So prayers to a speedy and a smooth recovery for one Steve Sarkisian, the California native of who served as the offensive coordinator for the Tide this past season. Did a solid job. I mean, 2 1,000-yard receivers, Jerry Jeudy and Devontae Smith, a 1,200-yard running back in Najee Harris, and if not for injuries, Tua Tagovailoa would have been a 3,000-yard passer and would have been in New York for the Heisman presentation. He did have 33 touchdown passes to 3 interceptions prior to the hip injury he sustained against Mississippi State. But also, even in Tua's injury, Coach Sark did a phenomenal job of settling Mac Jones into things, and the young man ended the year with 14 touchdowns to 3 picks, including 13 touchdowns to just 2 interceptions in the 4 games he started in. Also, Alabama averaging 47.2 points per game with Sark in 2019. So prayers to a safe and smooth recovery for him. But we dive in and out. First topic of conversation here on the show. And it's interesting how, you know, I came home from the show on Monday. And one of the things I enjoy doing when I watch the playback on YouTube is I like to go in the chat line, look at the comment section, and see the type of questions being left in there. And this is why I encourage you, the fans, to not only call the show, but also leave your thoughts, your ideas, your questions in the chat line, because you never know, Steven. You know, I myself, I could pull out one of your questions and use it for a call segment, a call topic, or a topic of discussion. And a lot of you may think, you know, Steven doesn't care about the question I'm putting in here, and your question could be the very main question I pull out of the bag. That's why I encourage all of you to definitely throw your thoughts and your concerns there into the YouTube chat line. But on Monday, question came out on who will be or who needs to be the most improved player for the Crimson Tide. And honestly, you can throw a lot of names into this discussion. You could throw the entire team into the conversation just due to Alabama did not beat Auburn, did not beat LSU, did not compete or did not appear in the SEC championship game, did not win a conference title. It missed out on the college football playoff for the first time since its inception in 2014, did not win a national championship. And despite all of these things, and though the season was not as bad as what people make it out to be, Alabama still ended up with at least 10 wins, including a victory over Michigan in the Citrus Bowl. But it's still not the Crimson Tide standard. It's still not the Crimson Tide way of life. So there are a lot of names you can throw into this conversation, but the name first and foremost that must start the dialogue is Patrick Surtain II. He has to be the most improved player. He's got to pop this year, and he's got to pop now. And this is not to say that Surtain is not a great player, because he's a tremendous talent. He's got big work ethic. He's got a lot of potential. His teammates really like him. Son of a legendary player in terms of the NFL. But I'm gonna spit this to you from a pro perspective, an NFL perspective here. So for pro coaches, general managers, owners, they really don't care much about the third through seventh round draft pick. They really don't. I mean, they like drafting the guy. They appreciate bringing the guys in. It's a whole kumbaya thing. But if we're going to be honest here, a lot of those third to seventh round guys, they don't hit, they don't pop, they don't make the roster. Half of them don't even make the cut. They don't cut the mustard. And it's very rare that you find a sixth round quarterback who goes on to play in 9 Super Bowls and wins 6 of them. You don't see too many Tom Brady's walking around nowadays. I mean, Bill Belichick hit gold with Tom Brady. You don't see a lot of, you know, third round quarterbacks that win Super Bowls to become the biggest players in the game right now. Not too many Russell Wilsons are walking around the league. And Pete Carroll, he may not admit to it, but he struck gold in getting Wilson to Seattle. Even when you break this down to Alabama football, you don't see too many first-round talent safeties that get hurt, go in the fourth round, and become the highest-paid safety in the league. You don't see too many Eddie Jacksons walking around the NFL. Eddie Jackson, people are starting to compare him to one Ed Reed. So when you get a guy in the third through seventh round that does pop, that does hit, that does become special, it's more to love. It's gravy on the mashed potatoes. It's icing on the cake. You appreciate that. But a lot of those guys do not hit immediately. So coaches, owners, general managers, they're not really caring too much about that. The people they do care about, though, are those first and second round picks. And the reason why, that's where the money is. That's where the capital is. That's where the funds are. That's where the investment lies. They care about those first to second round picks. If a third to seventh round pick, if they mess up, oh, you can gloss over that. You can sweep that under the rug. You can let bygones be bygones. But let a first or second round pick not hit. Then it becomes a tizzy. Then it becomes a frenzy. And the coach and the owner and the GM are going, oh my God, Did I just hitch my $1 billion baby to a guy that's not popping? Did I just give $40 million to the wrong player? Did I just do this to the wrong guy? Did I just put all of my trust in the wrong individual? And you got the general manager running around like a chicken with its head cut off saying, if I just screwed the pooch on this, the owner's going to have my head. Because the first and second round picks, you're investing a lot in. It's the same in college football where Alabama football is concerned. The coaching staff here in Tuscaloosa, of course, you the fans, you care about every player. You treat every player as if they're your own children, and you're supposed to. But the second, the two stars, three stars, and the walk-on guys, if they make a mistake, if they screw something up, you're able to let it go like water off a duck's back. You're able to kind of, you know, slide that underneath the rug. That's not a big issue there. But when a five-star messes up, it becomes, oh, my gosh, Saban, he's stinking up the bed. Get him off the field. Pull him off the play. What the world is going on? This is a five-star. He's supposed to know better, do better, see better, act better. Saban, what in the world is going on? People expect more from five stars. Five stars are held to a standard in college football, just like those first and second round guys in the NFL held to a standard in terms of draft picks. So when I look at, you know, Patrick Surtain, he had a great freshman year. He had a good sophomore year, but he didn't hit the way a lot of Alabama fans wanted him, expected him, needed him to hit. And when it gets to the third year of a player in a program, whether you are a true junior, redshirt, sophomore, doesn't really matter, this is where these draft analysts are starting to study you. This is where Bucky Brooks and Daniel Jeremiah, Todd McShay, Mel Kiper Jr., they put you under a microscope, they pop the tape in on you, because they're trying to see, what do we have here? Do we have a highlight guy? Do we have a guy that pops? Do we have a guy that makes all the plays? What do we have here? By your third year in the program, that's where you're put under a huge, gigantic microscope. And Patrick Surtain knows this. The people around him know this. He's got to pop this year. And when you look at ever since the 2015 draft, and this is subsequently after the 2014 season, first year of the college football playoff, three programs can refer to themselves as DBU, that being Ohio State, Alabama, and LSU. Ohio State, since the 2015 draft, have had 11 DBs taken. Alabama's had 10 defensive backs taken. LSU has had 9, Clemson 4th with 7. But Ohio State, Bama, and LSU, the three main programs that can call themselves DBU. When you look at Coach Saban, since 2008, he's put 96 players in the NFL draft. 96. Of the 96, 20 of those were defensive backs. That's 21%. And of the 20 defensive backs that got drafted, 7 of those, that's 35%, all went in the first round. We're talking Kareem Jackson, who was drafted in the 09 draft. We're talking Mark Barron, who went 2012 first round. Dre Kirkpatrick went 2012 first round. D. Milner, 2013 first round. Ha-Ha Clinton Dix, 2014 first round. Marlon Humphrey, 2017 first round. Minka Fitzpatrick, 2018 first round. And all of the guys that I've mentioned, by year two in Alabama, they popped. They became highlight, must-see, must-watch players. Kareem Jackson popped in 08. 10 pass breakups, 1 pick. Mark Barron popped in 09. 7 interceptions, 11 pass breakups. Dre Kirkpatrick, he popped in 2010. 53 tackles, 7 pass breakups, 3 picks. D. Milner popped in 2012. 20 pass breakups, 2 picks. Ha-Ha Clinton Dix popped in 2012. 4 interceptions left the team. Minka Fitzpatrick popped in 2016 with 6 picks. Eddie Jackson could have popped his second year in 2014, but he had injuries that season. Of course, when Alabama got the coach in Mel Tucker in 2015 and you moved Eddie Jackson, the safety. We saw what happened. He popped. He had six picks that season, including two for touchdowns. So saying that right now, all of these guys hit by year two at Alabama. Patrick Surtain had some good moments last year, but there were also some moments where you kind of want to shake him and go, Patty, let's go! Surtain, let's go! What's the holdup? What's the problem? Get with the program! You're the son of a legend! Let's go! You kind of want to shake Patty a little bit. So this season, he's got to pop. He's got to be the most improved player. People have come on the show. They've talked about him. He's got to pop, and he's got to pop now. We take a break here on In My Own Words, just getting this thing started here on a Wednesday. Upon our return, we address your phone calls, your thoughts, your tweets, your texts, your questions. Bring them in here. Let's have a dialogue after this.
Every sports fan deserves the proper representation. Whitwill Sports introduces to you the Title Towel. Wave that title towel in the air like you just don't care in support of Nick Saban and the Alabama Crimson Tide. Only $9.99 and it lasts a lifetime. Head on over to WhitwillSports.com and get your title towel today. Touchdown Alabama Magazine is Alabama football's premier publication. A subscription to Touchdown Alabama Magazine is the perfect gift for any Alabama fan. For exclusive news and information, recruiting updates, a free annual print magazine, and more, go to touchdownalabama.com and click join. Only $5.95 per month or pay $49.95 for a full year subscription. That's a saving of almost $22. Go to touchdownalabama.com today and roll tide.
As we're back in from the break, folks, you know, John, I'm trying to lay off the desserts, but everybody talking about pound cake in the YouTube chat. I mean, some Emily's heirloom pound cakes would sound pretty good right now, huh, John?
Yeah, they would. They would.
I mean, trying to lay off the sweets, but people talking about pound cake in the YouTube chat. We appreciate everybody jumping on here on a Wednesday. But it's your time, Tide Nation, 205-448-1358. The number to call in to let your voice be heard on the show, 205-448-1358. And one more time, 205-448-1358. And we start things off, as always, with Wayland. Happy Wednesday, hump day to you, man. Welcome in, Wayland.
Hump day, hump day, hump day. Hey, 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 it's TDA. It is Wednesday. How's everybody doing down at TDA on this Wednesday evening there, Stephen? Talk to me.
Doing well, man. Doing well. Just trying to get some motivation fired up for Patrick Surtain this season. You know, the defensive back, son of a legend in the NFL, and Pat Surtain Jr. Just got to get the young man to pop this year. Got to get young Patty Surtain the second to pop this year and do his thing in the secondary.
Yeah, that's what we were discussing there in the chat, along with that pound cake. And the secondary is going to have to step up this year, there's no doubt. And that offensive line gels. We'll go back to these teams that we had in 11 and 12 and maybe high, maybe 9. That was a heck of a team, 09 was. But I tell you what, you get that secondary right, that offensive line right, where we can throw the ball and run it, there ain't no stopping Alabama, Stephen. There ain't no way to stop them.
I'm saying this right now, Wayne, and I think the offensive line is already ready to go. I mean, when you look at what Kyle Flood is putting together as the coach, you look at the talent back on this group. I mentioned on Monday about how Pierce Quick is really starting to emerge as somebody that could potentially start an offensive guard, left guard this season. People are really high on him within the program. This is a front line that knows the expectations. It's Joe Moore Award or a huge disappointment. It's getting Najee Harris. His individual goals or a big disappointment. Also win a national championship or a big disappointment. So I feel like the line, the front line, they know what's at stake. They know what they have to do. It's just making sure the secondary falls in line, starting with Surtain. But knowing Coach Saban, who works very closely with the defensive backs, he's got some up his sleeve.
Yeah, he's got a few tricks left up his sleeve. There's no doubt about that. And the secondary steps up there will be all right. Y'all, I'm like you. I think the offensive line is on. I believe they're just about right on top of the game, get the running game going. So, but hello to everybody in the chat. We're getting a couple of poems ready for Friday. We'll we'll pop out of here maybe and have a good weekend on Friday. Like I said, hello to everybody in the chat. And everybody stay safe on Thursday, and we'll be back on Friday. And I guess we'll just end it like that tonight, Stephen. We appreciate that. And that young man said he sure did appreciate that picture. So, hey, we made a kid smile. Hey, you can't beat that. That makes a good day, my friend. Y'all have a good Wednesday down at TDA. We'll catch y'all Friday, Stephen. Bye-bye.
Appreciate that, Waylon. Got to give Dorito Bag his print there, his commemorative print there of Trent Richardson. But we continue in the call-in queue on a Wednesday. Got ahead of myself on a Wednesday. You're live on the show. What's going on?
Hey, thanks for taking my call, Stephen. I just wanted to address kind of the impact that coronavirus is going to have on the season. Obviously, it already has, with there being no spring practice, you know, no A-Day. And you know, I've been hearing you talk so much about how the defense, how you see that the defense is going to make a lot of improvements this year, but it's hard for me to not be skeptical when they've lost so much practice time. You know, people like Shane Lee, Christian Harris, Patrick Surtain, like you were just talking about, I don't see how they're going to be able to make the kind of strides that we need them to make when they've lost so much practice time. You can only get so much from Zoom calls and keeping up with the workout regimen. I mean, what do you think about that? You know, am I being overly pessimistic when I say that?
You're not being overly pessimistic. Of course, there's a concern, but the second part of the 6-week practice plan module that the NCAA did approve of, it starts July 24th through August 6th. And that module actually has where Coach Saban and the players, so they can be on the field. They can go through 7-on-7, 11-on-11 drills, and they can have those teachable moments on the field to get those practice reps up to speed. And then that will go into, of course, fall camp, which would start on August 7th should everything try to flow in here. But it is difficult not having the spring, because in the spring, you're used to getting that action in early, getting that action in quick, 15 days of practice, including the spring game, having people watch you go through the series of training, and then go home and then have the summer workouts and continue on with that. But with the second part of the module starting July 24th, I think Saban will find a way on the field to catch a lot of these guys up to speed, especially the freshmen that are in here now.
So you're not really concerned about the development of the freshman class last year? You think they'll be able to make strides this offseason, what they'll have of it?
I believe so. I mean, just thinking of Shane Lee for a minute here. Shane Lee was not a terrible player last year. He put up some good numbers stats-wise. What he just needs is to get his speed in order. That's why Dr. Matt Ray is in the program as a speed specialist. Shane Lee gets his speed in order. He can drop about maybe, you know, 5 to 10 pounds or so, but get that speed in order. That's all that Shane Lee needs. The same thing with Christian Harris, just, you know, fine-tuning some things as far as the, you know, reading the play, getting to there. But the guys that played last year, it was huge experience for them. They just need to clean up, you know, a couple of areas.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that's it's almost a blessing in disguise when you think about how, you know, we had so many injuries on defense last year and it was such a detriment. But really now you've got those guys that had to start in place. And they've got an entire year of experience under their belt. So I think we will have incredible depth at the linebacker position. I think we're going to have advantages over teams like Clemson, even though they've got Brent Venables or, you know, LSU. I think our depth at the linebacker position will be really unparalleled. So that is, in a sense, a good thing now that we've got so much depth there.
Absolutely, man. We'll definitely see how they do in this season. But I appreciate the call and keep listening to us.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Absolutely. We continue with the calls here on a Wednesday. You're live on In My Own Words. What's going on?
Hey, Stephen, it's Spencer Reevely. I'm going to make this short and sweet because I know your time running out on this first segment here. So I'm just going to talk about these great defensive backs that we sent on to the NFL. The one thing they all had in common, we had a great defensive line putting a push up the middle, push off the ends, putting pressure on these quarterbacks, what made them so good. What's your thoughts on that one?
That's true. And you look at Christian Barmore and DJ Dale and LeBron Ray, among others. If they can get that push this year, probably could see some Will Anderson in action if he can come in here, you know, as a freshman and make a huge impact. If Bama can get the push with the defensive run, we will see, you know, some interceptions, some pick sixes, some big turnovers. So good point there, Spencer. Got to get the push up front.
Yes, sir. I do agree with you. I'm very impressed with the talent we have coming back this year, and I really, truly feel that we're going to see a Bama defense that we're used to seeing here as fans.
It's going to be an exciting season, my man. But as always, appreciate the call, Spencer. Keep rocking and rolling with us.
Thank you, sir. Have a good rest of your show, sir.
We're going to go to another break here, folks, as you guys lighten this up here on the phone lines. Also, continue to light us up on the YouTube chat line as well. But upon our return, we sit down with former Alabama wide receiver Matt Caddell to talk some more Crimson Tide football. Keep it locked right here. We're coming back.
Want delicious homestyle cooking, sushi, and hibachi? Check out Otoro Hibachi in the University Mall in Tuscaloosa, Alabama. At home and you can't get away from the TV because the Crimson Tide is about to score? Don't worry, delivery is also available through Waitr and Crimson2go. That's Otoro Hibachi in the University Mall in Tuscaloosa, Alabama. And make sure you let them know the good folks at Touchdown Alabama sent you. Touchdown Alabama Magazine is Alabama football's premier publication. A subscription to Touchdown Alabama Magazine is the perfect gift for any Alabama fan. For exclusive news and information, recruiting updates, a free annual print magazine, and more, go to touchdownalabama.com and click join. Only $5.95 per month or pay $49.95 for a full year subscription. That's a saving of almost $22. Go to touchdownalabama.com today and roll tide.
We're back in from the break, folks, on a Wednesday hump day, hottest show on the streets, number one form of Crimson Tide football news, notes, and information. In my own words, with yours truly, your man, Stephen M. Smith of Touchdown Alabama Magazine. As always, got the man, John Ivory, in the production studio doing his thing. And as always, people, be sure to give a thumbs up, a like on the show, hit that subscribe button, turning all of those notifications on so that you can have the best in alerts, updates, and analysis on your favorite program, the Crimson Tide. But we hop on over to the phone lines. We pick up former Alabama wide receiver Matt Caddell, who typically usually joins us on Wednesday, playing for the Crimson Tide from 03 to 07. Matty Ice, what's going on?
How's everything going? Glad to be back on the show.
Good to have you here, Matt. Well, there have been moments on this show where we featured former players such as yourself, Chris Rogers, also Roman Harper was on last week, did an outstanding job. We've even featured a couple of recent former guys. And the common theme has been, you know, Alabama's got to get back to being tough, got to get back to being nasty, being physical, being dominant. Now, Alabama was not Alabama football last year. And even though there were some injuries that came into play, different things that caused some chaos, people still saying, well, that's not an excuse. We still need to be Alabama football. So you played for the program. You were a part of this team. You were coached by Nick Saban. You were in those meeting rooms around the energy of this program. What does it take, or how does one go back to recapture that toughness when you talk Alabama football?
I just think the players just have to have that, you know, that dog, alpha dog type mentality, you know, starts in the off season, the workouts, just that relentless pursuit to, you know, be great, be dominant, just be physical, you know, on the defensive end. And I think with all these guys, majority of the defense coming back with a year under their belt, I think they're going to be hungry and have a mindset to, you know, set the tone on the defense and just be physical throughout the game. I think that's the most important thing for, as Alabama fans, what we want to see is just a physical defense. You know, you might get scored on, but just throughout the game, like, we want somebody to get, you know, be physical and hit them backwards, those type things, you know, just set the tone for the defense. I think it starts with leadership from the coaches, obviously. But, you know, having Dylan Moses back, I think he can be that kind of coach on the field and really help lead the guys and let them know what we want as a defense and kind of get that plan executed. And I think with Dylan Moses' leadership and then having the freshman guys kind of have another year under their belt, and them being hungry to prove, I think they just have to go out there and set the tone and just be physical, make sure they wrap up, you know, finish plays, just hit guys backwards, all that good stuff. So I think it just kind of starts with there. And I think hopefully we have football this year. We'll be able to see that from the Crimson Tide defense.
Now, Matt, what's crazy here is, and I know you saw this as well, this week we looked at, you know, Patrick Mahomes of the Kansas City Chiefs brought in, you know, sports history, the first $500 million deal in the history of athletics when you talk about a 10 to 12 year deal worth $502 million. I mean, it's crazy. Now, as great as this was for Patrick Mahomes, and as great as it was for the Chiefs, this is huge for Lee Steinberg, the agent that got this done. I mean, prior to Mahomes' deal, the biggest deal that was done by the Steinberg organization was 1984, the Steve Young deal in the USFL that was $42 million. Now, Steinberg is also representing Tua Tagovailoa, former Alabama quarterback who's now in the pros with the Miami Dolphins. Seeing how Steinberg got Pat Mahomes paid, If you're the Tagovailoa family, and if you're Tua, what realistically does it have to take for Tua to get remotely close to what Mahomes has just brought in?
Well, I just think Mahomes set the bar so high.
You know, high.
Yeah, he won the NFL MVP, you know, basically his first year. He would have had a Super Bowl that year if it hadn't been for the Tom Brady and the Patriots, and they beat the Patriots, they probably end up beating the Rams in a rematch in that epic game on Monday Night Football. But he could easily possibly have, you know, if they win that year, that Super Bowl, he could easily have two Super Bowls under his belt, only in his third year, I believe. So you know, Mahomes is kind of in his own lane. He's kind of in his own universe almost. So, but, you know, he's kind of set the blueprint for other quarterbacks. So, obviously, for Tua, what's important for him is to continue to develop. You know, don't take those unnecessary hits. And I think it's more important for Miami, you know, to really build the program, the offensive system around his strengths. You know, get him some weapons. Get a scheme. I know they have Chan Gailey. He's more of the spread type of offensive mind. And I think if they do that and Tua continues to develop, he's got to win an NFL MVP, and he's got to, you know, at least bring one Super Bowl.
So that is a requirement from you.
I think so. If he wants to get that $500 million type of money, if he wants to get that Mahomes level money, I believe, he has the potential to bring the Super Bowl to Miami, and I think Miami fans will want a Super Bowl in Miami. So for him to get that Mahomes-like money, I think he has to obviously win an MVP and bring a Super Bowl.
If you're just tuning into the show, ladies and gentlemen, on a Wednesday, we got former Alabama wide receiver Matt Caddell on the line, who played from 2003 to 07. Also, Matt, I've gotten the chance to speak to, you know, former Auburn running back Brad Lester, and also another, you know, former player in the NFL, Derek Blaylock, a running back. Both guys helping Najee Harris get faster, get more speed, you know, under his belt, or adding more speed to the arsenal for the upcoming season. And when you look at Najee, what are your expectations for him? He's got expectations for himself. Brad Lester talked about the expectations he has, you know, 1,500-yard season, be in New York for the Heisman, be a first-round pick. But you, once again, played at Alabama. What would be your expectations this season, you know, for Harris as he enters a senior year to where he's eyeing a lot of these individual accolades?
I just think, you know, him to continue to develop, you know, he's putting in the work this offseason, and I really want to see it transition into the field. because I think our offensive line is really good, and they're going to open some holes. So, you know, I really want to see him attack the hole and really just once he hits that hole, just go and get to that next level, make a guy miss and score. I think that's the kind of the next level of elite running backs that he's trying to get to. And I think, you know, in his off season, he's going to be doing that. What he has been doing, I think it's going to show this year. Just him to continue to better improve as a receiver. He's great out of the backfield. With the ball in his hands and the passing games, it makes us more effective, efficient on the offensive end. You know, just he said he's, you know, running lower, more explosive with his pass. Just continue to work on that explosiveness and agility and quickness. You know, I think sky's the limit for him. I think he'll be obviously the top running back coming out the SEC. He'll probably be a finalist for the Doak Walker with Chuba Hubbard at Oklahoma State and Travis Etienne. So those are probably the three finalists. So hopefully he can win. And if he has an exceptional game and some big games on Alabama's calendar this year, he'll definitely be in that Heisman conversation at the end of the year.
Looking forward to seeing what one Najee Harris does this season for the Crimson Tide. But as always, we've got Matt Caddell, former Alabama receiver, played from 2003 to 07 on the line here. So, Matt, so a lot of Alabama fans, they kind of have like a funny moment with this, especially on defense. They look at it like, you know, the best guys we've seen on this defense are guys that had criminal records or guys that had, you know, criminal intentions, guys that were just mean, nasty, tough guys with beards, you know, that type of ordeal. When you discuss Alabama's group on the defensive side of the football, if there's literally one trait, if you can name one trait that this Bama defense just has to have, that one trait they've got to have this season and carry it consistently, what's the one trait?
They just got to have a tenacious mentality. They got to be some dogs. You know, you look at Alabama's defenses in the past, you had like pure dogs on the defense. You had Reuben Foster, you know, Rashawn Evans, you know, Minka was a dog. Deron Payne, just dogs all over the field. And I think, you know, we kind of got out of, you know, away from that with the, you know, influx of the spread offense. And so I think for us to defend the spread, it'll be a little bit more finesse, but you still can be physical and have that tenacity. And when guys get the ball, make sure you lay the wood, just real physical with them. You look at LSU against Clemson in the national championship, as that game progressed, LSU kept getting more physical and more physical with Clemson, where Clemson was, they didn't want it anymore. So I think that's kind of the standard to kind of have your defense moving forward is, you know, as the game goes on, you got to continue to have that dog mentality, be physical, tenacious, and keep laying the wood on these guys. And I think that kind of changes the game, changes the game for the defense as well as the team. So I think if Alabama does that, kind of have that tenacious dog mentality and just physical for 60 minutes throughout the game in their hitting and tackling, I think that Alabama will start, the Alabama fans will definitely start to see kind of that old Alabama defense. And I think that's the number one trait that we've got to get for our defense to be, you know, successful this year.
He's Matt Caddell, former Alabama wide receiver, played from 2003 to 07, joining us live here on a Wednesday hump day, talking some Crimson Tide football. Matt, as always, appreciate the time, the insight, the laughs, the joy that you bring to the show, man. As always, be good, man. Be safe out there.
All right, thanks, and always, Roll Tide.
Enjoy having Matt Caddell on as he joins us typically on Wednesdays to talk Crimson Tide football. But we take another break here, folks. But don't touch that dial. You get another opportunity to have a dialogue, a conversation, a powwow, if you will, with your man, yours truly. When we get back, we entertain more of your phone calls, your thoughts, your tweets, your chats. Bring them in here right after this.
Brown Menswear in the University Mall in Tuscaloosa.
Touchdown Alabama Magazine is Alabama football's premier publication. A subscription to Touchdown Alabama Magazine is the perfect gift for any Alabama fan. For exclusive news and information, recruiting updates, a free annual print magazine, and more, go to touchdownalabama.com and click join. Only $5.95 per month or pay $49.95 for a full year subscription. That's a saving of almost $22. Go to touchdownalabama.com today and roll tide.
We back in moving, folks, from the break on the hottest show on the streets, the number one forum for all things Crimson Tide football news, notes, and information. In my own words, with yours truly, Stephen Smith of Touchdown Alabama Magazine. And how about a quick shout out here to the man, Joe Calissi. Happy birthday, Joe. Joe Calissi, one of our faithful listeners in the chat line, celebrating his birthday. So big ups there to Joe. But as we're back in live here, on the show, 205-448-1358, for the number to call in to let your voice be heard, 205-448-1358. And one more time, 205-448-1358. Definitely want to hear from you, your thoughts, your viewpoints, your opinions on your favorite program, the Crimson Tide. As you're getting your thoughts together here, Alekaho, Brandon Alekaho, the junior linebacker from Nevada, who Alabama got in the 2018 class, flipped him from Washington. He is ready to make a big splash this year. And he posted this video on Twitter the other day of this man lacing up the cleats, getting out there, being a terror on special teams. And I'm going to be honest here. When I watch Caho play, there are three former Tide players come to my mind in terms of physical build, physical makeup, then the energy, the effort, the desire, the want to, the physicality, the toughness. There's three different players that come to mind. C.J. Mosley comes to mind first. Alekaho and Mosley share the same physical build when Mosley was at Alabama. And then in terms of the desire, the physicality, the toughness, the want to be on the field, Caho resembles both Reuben Foster and Mack Wilson. Funny I mentioned both of those two because both guys started off as special teams terrors on kickoff return cover, on kickoff coverage, punt coverage, prior to being, you know, inside linebackers. And Reuben Foster, we all remember the 2014 season where Alabama took on LSU, Tiger Stadium, Death Valley in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. The kickoff went to Leonard Fournette, and all of a sudden, number 10 coming down the field with bad intentions. Reuben Foster laid Leonard Fournette out. The whole crowd, the whole Bama part of the crowd went absolutely nuts. LSU crowd went, who in the world is that? That was Reuben Foster laying out Leonard Fournette. And then 2016, we all remember, Alabama against Texas A&M at Bryant-Denny Stadium when Mack Wilson went down, flying down the field, and he hit Speedy Noel so hard, he knocked the young man's tooth out of his mouth, so he had to go to the dentist to get that situation patched up. But you saw there, two guys starting off special teams terrors. They earned that trust from the coaching staff, and it transitioned to them being big play linebackers. But before we continue with the conversation, we go now to the phone lines where we pick up a call. You're live on In My Own Words. What's going on?
What's going on, Stephen? How are you?
Man, I cannot complain, man. Doing well.
Yeah, I hear a lot of talk about Najee Harris and seeing the interviews you've had with the guys past few days. Want to know your thoughts and see if he might be used like Derrick Henry was back in 2015, or where he ran about 30-40 times a game. Is that something we might see this year?
It's something we could see. It comes down to the aggressiveness of Najee Harris. How aggressive can he be from start to finish? How wanting the football, how dominant can he be with the football from the start of the year to the end of the year? We saw it against LSU. Something different happened. Something different clicked. He got way more confident, and he started to really run like people thought he would run as a five-star when he came in 2017. So that's a possibility. It's going to be tough seeing how you have a roster full of backs. Brian Robinson is going to want to touch the football. Keegan Robinson, Trey Sanders, along with you got three freshmen as well. But I do see it as a possibility. The main thing, though, can Najee be aggressive? Can Najee want it from start to finish, starting week one against USC. That will be the tale of the tape.
All right. Thanks for taking my call. Real tight.
Absolutely. Can Najee Harris want that thing from start to finish? If he does, I can see him getting 30 to 35 carries a game like Derrick Henry did. Henry wanted it from start to finish. He knew he had to be the man, so he had to be the man, and he put on the physical weight. He put on the muscle to be the man. But going back to just finishing the topic there on Alakaho, starting off, special teams terror, you know, three blocked punts this past season, perfected that side of the game. When you talk to players about him, they mention how much of a dog he is, how much he wants to be on the field. He desires to be on the field. He desires to make plays. And when he wasn't blocking punts, Alabama even used him on offense in goal line situations as a fullback H-back. And Najee Harris, Brian Robinson combined had 18 rushing touchdowns, quite a few of those. Alakaho was the lead blocker on the play. So it's going to be fun watching him this season take that next step and being a linebacker. According to people I've spoken with, he's expected to start in the dime package as the dime linebacker in the dime package. He will get worked into some nickel formations as well, but he's expected to start there in that dime rotation. But in other news here, the University of Alabama football program going into mobile tickets, mobile-only tickets for the University of Alabama. This came out from the Crimson Tide's athletic department. Starting with the 2020 season, Alabama going more so into mobile-only tickets and mobile-only, you know, for the tickets and for the parking as well. This is creating a safer environment for fans due to the global pandemic of the coronavirus, not having the fans go to the Tide Pride ticket office on campus inside Coleman Coliseum, or not having to go to different areas to get the tickets. You can have these come to your phone. You can have these come to your iPhone or your Android. You can download those tickets via the apps there. So they're doing this different here, making all the tickets mobile. So if you go to the Alabama Athletics Department here on the apps there, you can access the season tickets, the home game tickets, the neutral site tickets, the away game tickets, and also the parking passes as well. Now, in purchasing those tickets, you can have those downloaded to your phone via Apple Wallet for the iPhone or the Google Pay Wallet for the Android phone. So, in trying to be safer, but also stopping the production of counterfeit or fraudulent tickets, the Alabama Athletics Department, the communication side of things, they're trying to do this in a more digital way, having the mobile-only tickets sent to the phone to, you know, appease fans, create a safer environment for fans that way. So if you're trying to get tickets this season, go do the mobile option, do the mobile-only option, courtesy of the Alabama Athletics Department, getting those tickets from the Apple Wallet, downloading those, Apple Wallet for the iPhone, Google Pay Wallet for the Android phone. But we're taking another break here, folks, on the show. As always, continue to light us up in the YouTube chat line with your thoughts, your concerns, your questions, your chats there. But upon our return, we dive into one Charles Huff. Everybody is keen on, you know, Pete Golding's got to step up. Pete Golding's got to come up. Pete Golding's got to do right. And though that's true, I'll dive into why Charles Huff has some pressure on him as well to take that next step forward, and we'll touch it up right after this.
If you're an avid Alabama Crimson Tide fan and you love to flaunt it, then show your Alabama Crimson Tide support by grabbing the All-Bama sneakers. They feature bold Crimson Tide graphics, so no one will be able to question where your allegiance lies. When you add these sweet sneakers to your Alabama Crimson Tide collection, go to stsfootwear.com and use the code TDAlabama for $15 off your purchase. That's code TDAlabama for $15 off your purchase. Go to stsfootwear.com and get your All-Bama sneakers today.
Touchdown Alabama Magazine is Alabama football's premier publication. A subscription to Touchdown Alabama Magazine is the perfect gift for any Alabama fan. For exclusive news and information, recruiting updates, a free annual print magazine, and more, go to touchdownalabama.com and click join. Only $5.95 per month, or pay $49.95 for a full year subscription. That's a saving of almost $22. Go to touchdownalabama.com today and roll Tide.
All right, Tide Nation, we are back into the number one source, number one form of Crimson Tide football news, notes, and analysis, commentary, information, in my own words, with yours truly, Stephen M. Smith of Touchdown Alabama Magazine. Appreciating every last one of you for checking us out on today. And as always, be sure to drop a like, give a thumbs up on the show, and hit that subscribe button, turning on all of those notifications, so that way you can have the best in news, notes, analysis, and content on your favorite program. But everyone talking about, you know, Pete Golding. Coach Golding has to come up this year, has to do better this year. Defense must be in the top five in every major defensive category, because if it's not, running Pete Golding out of town. Pete Golding has a lot of pressure on him. Pete Golding has a lot on him to try to excel at and get done. But aside from Coach Golden, of which we know has the pressure on him, who would be another guy on this coaching staff, another position coach on this roster that he's got to take the next step forward? He's got to come higher in the case of making this program run smoothly, especially this season. And the guy that I thought about was running backs coach Charles Huff. Running backs coach Charles Huff has got to take that next step forward. And the reason why I brought him up was Barton Burns, the time he was with the Crimson Tide from 2007 to 2017, we're talking about the best running backs coach, not just in Alabama history, but one of the best coaches, position coaches in football, in college football history. When you think running backs, you think of Barton Burns. And this was somebody that produced so many, you know, 1,000-yard guys at Alabama. He put so many guys in the NFL. He had two guys win the Heisman Trophy in Mark Ingram and Derrick Henry. He had multiple guys win the Doak Walker Award. He had guys to win the Maxwell Award. Like, Barton Burns got it done in terms of running backs. He coached you hard. He coached you tough. He coached you right. He made sure you held the ball high and tight. No fumbles. But the biggest thing that Coach Burns excelled at, he never tried to change a running back, right? If you had a specific skill set that made you unique, that made you different, that made you stand out, he wanted to hone in on that. He wanted to fine-tune you on that. He wanted to push it out of you, right? You never saw Kenyon Drake trying to be Derrick Henry. Kenyon Drake was Kenyon Drake. He was speed in the hole, quickness in the hole, burst out in the open field with that acceleration. Mark Ingram, Trent Richardson, Eddie Lacy, TJ Yeldon, you know, all the guys that Barton Burns coached, they stuck true to themselves. They never tried to be, you know, like any other running back. They were themselves. So when I look at Charles Huff, hopefully he took a lot of lessons, he took a lot of notes, he took a lot of information, he took a lot of quality teaching from, you know, Coach Burns, because he's going to need it. Huff is entering his 15th season coaching running backs, whether that be in the pro level or at the collegiate level. He's coached 7 1,000-yard seasons, including Najee Harris this past year, you know, 1,224 yards. Three of those 1,000-yard years he had in Saquon Barkley at Penn State, 2015 through 2017. During Huff's time at Mississippi State, he did have quarterback Nick Fitzgerald that ran over 1,000 yards as well. But if you look at just the strengths of Coach Huff, when I got a chance to talk to people within the program, the strengths for Coach Huff: strong recruiter, big time recruiter. He got the commitments for 2021. He's landed the verbal commitments of J.C. Latham, Ja'Cory Brooks, Devontae Smith, and Dallas Turner. So big time recruiter is Charles Huff. He's big on effort. Huff is like the football version of Alabama men's basketball head coach Nate Oates. Nate Oates knows There are going to be some nights where the shots are not going to fall. The mid-range jumpers are not going to fall. The three-point shots not going to fall. But you better be hustling up and down the court. You better be snatching them offensive and defensive rebounds. You better be putting your body on the floor for them loose balls. You better be taking them charges. You better be hustling your floor off. Because if you ain't hustling, I'm putting your behind on the bench. I'm putting your behind on the bench. If you're not giving me no effort, you ain't on this court. That's Nate Oates. And that's, to a lot of extent, what Charles Huff is. If the running backs are not giving effort, he's not playing those guys. So he's good in recruiting. He's good on effort. He's good on ball security. I did not see a ton of fumbles from Alabama running backs last year, if any at all. So he's good on ball security. In terms of things that Coach Huff needs to work on, aggressiveness. And I mentioned this in the last no call segment. He's got to get these backs aggressive from start to finish. They got to want to dominate the game from the first matchup to the very last matchup of the season. So aggressiveness was a big key for him that he's got to work on. Number two, he's got to be good and keen on, you know, the details. So, for example, going back to all of the running backs that Alabama had under, of course, you know, Burton Burns as the position coach. When you look at, you know, those guys, they all studied three respective positions. They studied the defensive ends, they studied the outside linebackers, and they studied either the boundary corner or the safety. And the reason why they studied those three positions is if those guys are cheating too much outside, they can be able to cut the play inside off of the tackle or the guard, one cut, get inside between the tackles. Be intentional, run the football, do your business. Or if they saw those guys' body language cheating too much, you know, inside, then they would have the speed to bounce the play out to the outside, get to the corner, get to the perimeter. So they studied the defensive ends, the outside linebackers, now the boundary corner, you know, or the safety. And by the first 2 to 3 seconds where the ball touched the hands of those running backs, they knew what they were going to do. Their minds were made up. Their minds were fixed in on, I know where I'm going with this football. So it's attention to details. That'll be huge there for Coach Huff taking that step forward. And then last but not least, honing in on the already skill set, you know, for a lot of these guys and pushing that skill set out of them. So for Najee Harris, even though, you know, people are trying to add more speed to his game, things that we can expect from Najee Harris, spin move, hurdle, stiff arm, we can expect those things. And continuing to fine-tune those things and push those things, you know, out of Najee Harris. When I look at Brian Robinson at 6'1", 230 to 235 pounds, we got to have power. One cut, be aggressive, get in there, run guys over, power. There were a lot of times, you know, last year where I feel like Brian Robinson looked at Najee Harris and we're trying to take some things from here. No. You are power, Brian. You are get in the hole, do damage, mean business, be intentional about getting north and south in between the tackles. And Coach Huff has got to push that out of him. Get in between the tackles. Keegan Robinson, his big thing, speed. Get in the hole, quick feet, burst, get for the next level. Now, you can add some power things to his game, but speed is his primary skill set there. Trey Sanders, as we continue to learn more about him, you push the primary skill set out of him, and even down to the young freshmen, the Jace McClellans, Roydell Williams, and Kyle Edwards's, you know, of the world. And for Coach Huff, there's going to be moments this season where there's going to be moments, games, matchups, possessions to where Coach Saban is going to simultaneously look at Coach Huff and Coach Cal Flood and say, all right, fellas, give me a drive. I want to dive into the well. I want to dive into the reservoir. I want to run the football. I want to play smash mouth. I want to wear this opposing defensive line down. Give me a drive. And it's going to come down to Coach Huff and Coach Flood to have this offensive line. Coach Huff, have those running backs ready to pound the football know, up and down the field. Coach Sampson, look at those two guys and demand, you know, a big play drive, you know, eating 10 and 12 and 15, you know, having those 10, 12, 15 play drives where you're taking time off the clock there. So that's going to be big there for Coach Huff in the upcoming season. I know people want to see Pete Golding improve, Pete Golding come up, but along with Coach Golding, Charles Huff, the next guy there. So, as always, folks, you want the best news, notes, information, coverage on your Alabama football program. It's very simple, very easy to do this. You can do this by accessing, downloading the Touchdown Alabama Magazine app for your iPhone App Store if you're rocking Team Apple, Google Play Store if you've got the Android phone. For your audio listening needs, we got you covered. iTunes or Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Stitcher, Spreaker, TuneIn Radio, Google Play, Overcast.fm, or iHeartRadio. If the good and gracious Lord sees fit, I will return Friday to continue talking Crimson Tide football. Also, be sure to purchase your individual copies of Touchdown Alabama Magazine. Have those sent to your door. Link will be found in the description. But until next time, folks, husbands, love your wives. Wives, appreciate, value those husbands. Children, continue doing those things to legitimately not be bored. Get those three hearty meals a day, those three great laughs a day. Protect yourself. Protect the loved ones around you. Till next time, folks, I'm your man, Stephen M. Smith, and this has been In My Own Words.